So here what we have discussed, you have three different ways that a computer buses can be used to communicate with the memory and input output. We have seen the first way is separate buses for the memory and the input output. So there is no confusion for the CPU. If it wants to communicate to the memory, this bus can be used. If it wants to communicate to the input output devices, it takes the help of input output processor through a separate input output bus. Now in the second case also, which you call as the isolated input output, there I am going to have a common address and data bus, but separate control lines will be used. So no problem. When this control line is given to the memory, then the CPU will understand, the CPU and memory will understand, now the communication is between these two. When these control lines are activated, the CPU and input output device will understand the communication is now between I/O devices and the CPU. But if you are going to have memory mapped input output, it is going to have the common address, data and the control lines. As we have seen here, we are going to have common control bus, common data bus, common address bus. Now the question is, if I am going to have common lines here, when an address is placed on the address bus, the system cannot understand whether it is the address of the memory or the address of the input output device. So what it is going to do, the same kind of address formats will be used for both memory and input output. Imagine I am going to have an 8-bit address. If so, please remember, you assume that there is a memory and there are two input output devices available. So what we are going to do, for these two input output devices and the memory, we are going to have a common format for the address. So that is what you call as same address space. I am going to call it as same address space. That is what it says. In the memory mapped input output, same address space for both memory and the input output. Why? Because now input output devices have become part of the memory address space itself. So whatever format of address you are going to use for the memory, the same format should also be used in the input output device or input output interface also. So that is why we say same address space will be shared for both memory and the input output. So this is the case in computers that employ only one set of read write signals, right? That is what you have seen in the diagram. I am going to have only one set of control lines, whereas in the previous case we had separate control lines, but here I am going to have common control line, only one set of control lines, both for the memory and the input output. So if this is the case, what you have to do, you have to go for the memory mapped input output. This kind of configuration is what you call as memory mapped input output. So in this configuration, your computer treats an interface register. Now suppose if you have two input output devices connected, two interface registers will be there. So one interface register for the first device, another interface register for the second device. So both these registers will also be treated as part of the memory system itself. So this problem will not arise in the isolated input output because it is going to use different set of registers for the memory and for the input output devices. And the assigned addresses for interface registers cannot be used for the memory word. This is the problem, because suppose if I have 8-bit address, two 8-bit addresses must be given for the interface register, and these two address bits cannot be used for the memory. These two addresses, suppose say for example, the first input output device, now I am going to give 00000, all 8 zeros I am going to give for the first interface register. And for the second input output device, you will have one interface register. Let us say 00001 I am going to give for the second input output device. So these two addresses now cannot be used for the memory. Appa memory in the address evidna start eya 00010. From that the memory address will be starting, and the memory address will not be starting from 0000 to 111. Adil nindayittu nammal endu cheydu 8 bit 000 and you will have 8 ones. That will be the range for the 8 bit addresses. Our range lile ella addresses cannot be used for the memory. So what you are going to do, the first two addresses or the last two addresses can be given to the input output interface, and the rest of the addresses can be used for the memory. So obviously this will be reducing the memory address range. So that is one of the drawback of the memory mapped input output. Now let us see what are the differences between the memory mapped input output and the isolated input output. So these are the major differences I can say between the memory mapped input output and isolated input output. This I have collected from the internet. So sometimes when you browse through, you can see these diagrams as well as the differences. So one, in the isolated input output, we have seen memory and input output will have separate address space, whereas in the memory map, both will have same address space. This is point number one. And the second difference, all the addresses can be used by the memory here. Isolated input output, if you have 8-bit addresses, the 8-bit address will be starting from 0000 to 111. All these addresses can be used by the memory. Whereas if it is memory mapped input output, some addresses you have to give to the input output register. So you will have lesser addresses for the memory. Then here in the isolated input output, we have separate instruction control. Control lines are separate. Whereas here in the memory mapped, same instructions can control both input output and memory. Here I am going to have separate control instructions because I have separate control lines. But here same instructions you have to give both for memory communication and the input output device communication. Then you have here in this input output addresses are called as ports. We are going to use the term port, underline the term port. If it is isolated input output, the input output address will be specified as port numbers. Whereas in the memory mapped input output, we use normal memory address for both input output devices as well as for the memory. Here I am going to give only the port number, but here we are going to use the same memory address itself for both input output and the memory. Now here in the isolated input output, it is very efficient because I am having separate buses. So you need not have a separate control lines and control signals to be generated to understand whether the communication is for the memory or the input output. So obviously here in the isolated input output, it is going to be very efficient. Whereas in the memory mapped input output, it is less efficient. Why? Because every time when the system wants to communicate with the memory, what it has to do? It has to place the proper address, proper data and the control lines. And this has to be decoded. A decoding process, interpreting process has to be done in the memory mapped input output. Why? Because same signals you are going to use both for memory and the input output. But that case will not arise in the isolated input output, because we have separate lines, so obviously when the signal is given to this line, it need not be interpreted. It can be understood that the signal is for the input output device or for the memory. Then another difference is it is larger in size due to more number of buses, but this is smaller in size. So when you see the hardware design, when you see the hardware design and all the connections between the hardware components, the isolated input output is larger in size, whereas memory mapped input output is smaller in size. Because and in the diagram itself you might have seen, right? In the diagram itself the size is larger here in the isolated input output, whereas the size is much smaller in the case of memory mapped input output. And the last one, and obviously isolated input output is complex in the case of hardware, because separate logic is used to control both memory and input output. The hardware architecture is complex here, whereas in the memory mapped it is a simpler logic, because simpler design, hardware design, and simpler logic is used because we are going to use a smaller size hardware configuration, right? So these are the differences between memory mapped input output and isolated input output. I think you might have understood what is a memory mapped input output method, what is an isolated input output method, and what is the role of input output processor in the case of connection between the CPU, input output devices, and the memory. Now, apart from this, we should also understand what is the configuration followed in the input output interface unit. So, what kind of components are available in the input output interface and how it is being used for the communication purpose? That is the next question. So this is an example of input output interface unit, and please see that don't get it confused, like all the computer system will be having this kind of input output interface unit, or for all these kind of input output devices we are going to have this kind of interface unit. No later devices or no later computer systems are having this interface unit. This is the interface unit which was proposed in a very very early stage, right? So the very basic design of the interface unit is shown here, but I just took it just to understand, like we are talking about interface eppozhum njan parayunnundayirunnu in between the CPU and the input output device I am going to have an interface unit. Appa obviously this interface unit is also a microcontroller, right? It is also a chip kind of thing. So what will be the components that are available inside this particular chip? That is what we are going to see here. Because when you have studied your microprocessor, you might have studied different components. There will be an arithmetic unit, there will be a logic unit. You have lots of registers, AX register, BX register, like that. You have lots of registers, and you will have a flag register. So like that you have different components available in your 8085 or 8086 microprocessor. In the same way, in between this 8085 microprocessor and your keyboard, you are going to place this interface between them. Now, when I say interface, this interface is also a chip, a microcontroller chip, which has some kind of components inside the interface. So these are the different components that are available inside the interface unit. So let us see how these components are connected to the different address line, data lines, or to the control lines. And you can see here, inside the interface unit you have a bus. Inside the interface unit you have a bus. And these are the different components which will be connected to the CPU, and these are the different components which will be connected to the input output device. I hope I make sense. These are the different components which will be connected to the CPU, and these are the different components which will be connected to the input output device. And I believe all of you are drawing the diagram and you take down the explanation also. So what we are going to do, you have a bus buffer here. Observe the buffer, and the buffer is connected to a bi-directional data bus. What do you mean by this? The CPU may be issuing a read signal or the CPU may be issuing a write signal. So if it is going to be a read signal from the buffer, the data will be transferred to the CPU. If it is a read signal, why do you give a read signal? The CPU wants to read something from the input device. So by the time, whatever is available in the buffer, this buffer data will be transferred through this data bus. Suppose if the CPU issues a write signal, whatever is available in the CPU, that will be moved to the buffer, bus buffer. So from this buffer, it will go through this internal bus, and from there it will go to a port register which is connected to one input device, and another port register which is connected to another input output device. Suppose imagine you have a keyboard, you have a printer. Let us assume you have a keyboard, you have a printer. So these are the only two devices connected to your processor. Assume there is a keyboard, there is a printer. These are the two devices connected to your processor, CPU. Correct? So what you need? You need only two registers in the interface unit. One register I can use for the keyboard. Another register I can use for the printer. So let us assume port A register is connected to the keyboard. Port B register is connected to the printer. So if it is a read signal coming from the CPU, what it is going to do? The port A register will be activated, and from the keyboard the data will be transferred here, and from here it will be moved to the buffer register, then it will go to the CPU. Correct? Whereas If it is going to be a write signal, from the CPU the data will go to the bus buffer, then from there it will go to this register, and from there it will go to the printer. This is how it will be designed. So inside the interface unit, depending upon the number of ports in the interface unit, the number of devices can be connected. So since in this interface unit I have only two ports, I am going to connect only two devices. So one I am going to connect to an input device, another one I am connecting to the output device. I hope I make sense here. So this data bus buffer is used for storing the data which will be transferred to and from the CPU. And these port registers will be connected to the devices for any one of the input output operation. Okay. Now, apart from that, we have also seen in the function commands, what are the different commands we will be giving? Control command can also be given. Status command can also be given. Apart from that, input output command can also be given. If so, what happens now? If it is going to be an input command, that will be given here in the read signal, or if it is output command, it can be given to the write signal. Fine. Now the question is, if it is going to be a control command or the status command, where this command is to be stored, for which you have the control register, you have the status register. So the control command that is coming from the CPU will be moved to the control register. Appa, how do you get it from the CPU? obviously this command will be given to the interface unit through the bus buffer, and then this command will be given to the control register, not to the ports, because it is not the data, it is a control command. So from the buffer it will be transferred to the control register. If it is going to be a status command, from the buffer it will be transferred to the status register. So status command will be stored in the status register to understand what is the status of the device. That is why you have the signal this way. This is the direction of the signal. You are not giving this status register here. Instead, it is just receiving the status of the input output device. Whereas control command is used for what? For activating the peripheral. So that is why we have this particular direction, right? The control command will be stored here. Accordingly, the signal will be generated, control signals will be generated, and it will be given to the input output device for the operation. Okay. Now, apart from these components, you can see a timing and control component is also available, digital component. What is the purpose of timing and control signal register? Sorry, not register, a component. To receive the read signal, to receive the write signal. Apart from that, it is also going to mention the chip select and the register select. Observe here, register select. Register select is having two lines. You can see here two lines. So when the CPU is placing a control command, when the CPU is placing a control command, what it is going to do? It is going to write that control in the control register. Yes. But what the CPU will do? It will issue the write signal and it will issue a signal in the register select. How? If the register select lines are having value 10, then the control register will be selected. And whatever value is stored in the buffer, that will be moved to the control register. Suppose if the CPU wants to read the status, what it is going to do? It will issue the read signal. Then it will issue the register select. How it will issue the register select line signal? 1, 1. So if both these lines are 1, 1, whatever command is placed here in the buffer will go to the status register. So from the status register, from the status register, it will take the data and it will get it in the buffer, then it will be transferred to the CPU because it is a read operation. Ille status register le enganeyanu, we want to read the status of the input output device. So if so, the status register will have the value and that value will be taken and it will be placed in the buffer. From the buffer, the CPU will receive the status. And this chip select line is used for selecting the entire interface unit, or it is used for activating the entire interface unit. Why? Because in your system, you may be having more than one interface unit. So when you have more than one interface unit, like this interface unit itself, you will have another interface unit. Suppose if you have four input output devices, you will be having two interface units like this. Because one interface unit, you say that any two device connect cheyanu. அப்போ ஆப்வியஸ்லி ஃபோர் டிவைசஸ் கனெக்ட் ചെയ്യാൻ ஐ நீட் டூ இன்டர்ஃபேஸ் யூனிட். இப்போ ரெண்டு இன்டர்ஃபேஸ் யூனிட் உண்டாகும்போது வாட் இஸ் த ப்ராப்ளம் ஹியர்? த சிபியூ ஹேஸ் டு செலக்ட் எனி ஒன் ஆஃப் த இன்டர்ஃபேஸ் யூனிட் ஃபார் த கம்யூனிகேஷன். ஹவ் வில் தி சிபியூ வில் செலக்ட் த இன்டர்ஃபேஸ் யூனிட்? பை யூசிங் த சிப் செலக்ட் லைன். ஸோ ஒன்லி இஃப் திஸ் லைன் இஸ் ஆன், யூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு activate this interface unit. So that is what is shown in this table. You can see here, if the chip select line is having 0, no matter whatever values are coming in, it goes into the high impedance state. That means it becomes inactive. It gets disconnected from the system. Whereas if the chip select line is 1, if the chip select line is 1, if the values in the register select is 00, port A value will be considered. If it is 01, port B will be considered. If it is 10, control register will be considered. If it is 11, status register will be considered. So this is how one interface unit will be functioning. So your interface unit consists of two data registers called ports. One is port A and port B. Then you have a control register, one control register, and you have one status register here. Then you have bus buffer, you have the bus buffer here, and you have a timing and control circuit. So these are the different components you have in the input-output interface unit. So all these input-output interface unit components will be communicating through the internal bus, and the interface will be communicating with the CPU through the data bus. So the data bus will be connected to the CPU. Through this data bus it will be communicating, and the chip select and register select inputs determine the address assigned to the interface. What do you mean by this? Chip select line is 1, and the values, input values in the register select will decide to which particular port or to which particular register the CPU is going to transfer the data. Okay, so the input output read and write are two control lines that specify an input or output respectively, and four registers communicate directly with the input output device attached to the interface. So this is how an input-output interface unit will be working. Yes. So we will be discussing the different data transfer schemes. What are the different modes of data transfer? We will be discussing in the next class.